Welcome back to the third episode of the Spartan Journal. Just as a reminder, this podcast is meant to keep you up to date and informed about the ever-changing world. I'm your host, Shadi Khamis, joined by our executive editor,
Alex Kaminski,
and our co-host,
Liam Rhattigan.
Today, we will be evaluating Cisco's acquisition of Splunk, economy trends with consumer spending, and an unexpected boost for the markets from Washington. The date is November 5th, 2023, and you're listening to the Spartan Journal.
Here are this week's market evaluations. The S&P 500 is up 198.39 points and 4.77% this week, while the Dow Jones Industrial Average is up 1,353.31 points and 4.14%. Finally, the NASDAQ is up 184.09 points and 1.38% this week.
The Russell 2000 is up 114.35 points and 6.95% this week, while the MSCI International is up 17.9 points and 3.75%. Barclays Bond Index is up 0.4 points and 6.27% this week. Here's our stock of the week, brought to you by Yahoo Finance. DraftKings, it is a sports betting site, and they recently reported their third quarter results, which were better than what they estimated them to be. They expect to now bring in between $3.67 billion and $3.72 billion this fiscal year. This looks like a strong future for DraftKings.
Thank you guys for this week's update. The market has made a bit of a comeback. The conclusion of our brief market evaluation leads us into our informational discussion portion, which I will start. Splunk, a data mining and cybersecurity company, is undergoing significant changes in preparation for its acquisition by Cisco. Cisco's planned acquisition of Splunk for $28 billion is notable in the tech industry, highlighting its strategic focus on enhancing enterprise data protection. The article also mentions that Splunk is anticipating around $42 million in costs related to these changes. Market reactions to the acquisition announcement, including Splunk's stock price, provide valuable insights into the financial implications. In the face of economic uncertainty, Splunk's CEO emphasizes the need for organizational adaptation to support efficiency and sustainability in the future. In my personal opinion, Cisco's acquisition of Splunk was a strategic move to enhance their presence in the cybersecurity and data protection sector, showing the increasing importance of these areas in the tech industry. What do you think about this, Alex?
Yeah, to add on to Shadi, including the restructuring costs are likely aimed at optimizing their operations for this new phase. It's possible that we'll see more strategic realignments in the tech sector as companies seek to strengthen their positions in growing markets.
Thank you for the insight, Alex, and special thanks to CNBC and Kelsey Zeiser for providing this article.
Thank you, Shadi. This week, we're discussing a recent article highlighting the anticipation of record holiday spending fueled by the enduring strength of the job market. Here's the rundown. Despite some economic headwinds, the job market's resilience seems to be emboldening customers to open their wallets this holiday season. The National Retail Federation is forecasting a sales growth of 3-4%, which, while not as high as last year's 5%, still surpasses the growth seen in the decade before the pandemic hit. It's not just wishful thinking. Nearly half of the consumers surveyed are gearing up to spend more on holiday shopping, with the average expected spend hovering around $875. This spending confidence is largely credited to the current job market and wage increases, which seem to offset concern about inflation and rising credit usage. Interestingly, while the Federal Reserve has been hiking up interest rates to combat inflation, job growth remains solid and consumer spending robust. Just last October, 150,000 jobs were added, a number lower than expected, but still strong enough to maintain a low unemployment rate by historical standards. Here's where the discussion gets even more nuanced. Bank of America chimes in, predicting a potential better spending year than the last. They believe that Americans have a positive sentiment based on their job security, personal finances, and despite rising prices, they still plan to spend. And then there's the mortgage rate angle, which many Americans having locked in lower rates in the past, there's a feeling of financial leeway that encourages spending despite the recent increases in mortgage rates. But it's not all smooth sailing. Consumers face challenges like high gas prices, increased credit usage, dipping savings, and persistent inflation. Yet, these headwinds don't seem strong enough to discourage spending. Plus, the data suggests that consumer debt isn't as alarming as it might appear. Delinquency rates are not high by historical standards, and the burden of debt like student loans may not be as pervasive as often portrayed. So listeners, what does this all mean for investors, retailers, and the economy at large? Is this consumer confidence a sign of robust economy, or are we overlooking the potential for a financial squeeze down the road? How should you and the businesses strategize to capitalize on the spending trend? And what about you, the consumer? Does this news affect your holiday spending plans? It's a fascinating juxtaposition of confidence amidst economic uncertainty, and it sets the stage for a deep dive into the psyche of the American consumer and the potential ripple effects on the market.
Alex, do you think that despite all the challenges the consumer faces in our economy today, that the holiday spending will still be as high as predicted?
Yeah, Liam, I definitely believe that the holiday spending will be as high as predicted, and if not, even higher. This year's had a lot of economic turmoil within our economy, and I believe the holiday spending will be a great way for consumers to get their minds off of the current day-to-day trends. Special thanks to Terry Lane and Investopedia for the insightful article in this podcast.
Thank you, Alex, for your valuable insight. Now, here's some exciting news I found on our markets today. In the world of finance, unexpected surprises can have profound impact on the markets. Recently, the Treasury Department delivered just such a surprise by tweaking its borrowing plans, which set off a chain reaction in both stocks and bonds. This move, coupled with signals from the Federal Reserve, sent yields on the 10-year U.S. Treasury note on a roller coaster ride. As we explore the dynamics of this financial shakeup, we'll uncover the reasons behind it, the reactions it triggered, and the delicate balances between economic growth, inflation control, and the limitations faced by the Treasury and the Federal Reserve. To start off, the Treasury Department's recent decision to increase the size of long-term debt auctions by a smaller amount than expected had a significant impact on both stocks and bonds. Another good thing is that the yield on the 10-year U.S. Treasury note, which had been a source of market anxiety, fell back to 4.557% after briefly surpassing 5%. A good sign in this is that the S&P 500 climbed 5.9% for the week, largely reflecting relief over the decline in yields. Moving on, the Federal Reserve hinted that it may not rise interest rates further this year. This played a part in lowering yields as well. Prior to this, there was a lot of commotion around the yield surging. Long story short, Treasury came out and said that they were going to overstep informal guideposts for how much in short-term Treasury bills to issue. This is big because it is against their norm to help out in a more elastic market like ours right now. And it paid off. The S&P 500 weekly gain was the biggest it's been in about a year. One thing to caution still, though, is the balance between economic growth and inflation control in the context of interest rates and yields. Both the Federal Reserve and the Treasury Departments are pursuing their own goals, with the Treasury seeking the lowest possible funding costs and the Fed interested in bringing down inflation while avoiding a recession. So the main goal is to find an interest rate to control inflation without stabbing the economy in the back. Even with the 4.9% growth in our markets, investors still worry about what data says, cautioning an uptick in unemployment and to see if the interest rates will finally set our economy over the top, making inflation worse again.
Liam, should we be worried about this continuing trend of inflation? And if so, what do you recommend consumers should do to prep for the future?
To answer this question, Alex, this is a personal problem, to be blunt. People who have bad spending habits may want to be more cautious with the spike in inflation, but people who have long-term stances in the market tend to beat inflation with their investments and should not worry. I suggest having a plan for your finances and our future if inflation does spike. Do I see this trend continuing, though? No, but it never hurts to prepare because you never know. Special thanks to Sam Goldfarb from Wall Street Journal for this amazing article. Always happy to hear interesting info about the financial markets.
With that being said, that wraps up our third episode of Season 4. Thank you for listening. If you enjoyed the content, please share this podcast from Spotify or YouTube. Look out for your fellow Spartans, and as always, go green.
If you enjoyed the discussion, please like and share the podcast on Apple and Spotify. The Spartan Journal podcast is part of Michigan State University's Wealth Management Association, a student organization whose goal is to inspire the next generation of financial advisors. The Spartan Journal news team releases a newsletter every Monday morning comprised of financial literacy and the week's market updates. Feel free to follow us on social media at MSUWMA and check out our website at msuwma.com. Anything heard on either the MSUWMA or Spartan Journal podcasts is for educational purposes only and should not be considered as investment advice.